What's up, guys? It's Angela, and I am here to do my main Pretty Little Liars theory on who I think Charles is. So I'm really sorry about the glare in my glasses, but I have about 4 pages of notes to talk about and clues, and I have to have them so I can read because I don't have any context at the moment. So before we begin this video, I'm going to show you guys what I've been working on, and I'm super excited about it. It's totally random, but this is in celebration of an Etsy shop that I am opening, and it is going to be my Ravenclaw blanket for Harry Potter, and in the middle is going to be the Wit Beyond Measure is a Man's Greatest Treasure, right in the middle there, and I'm super excited about it. I'm going to do a whole bunch of like literary themes, so that's just totally random, but I don't know. That's just what I've been working on, and I'm really proud of it, so I just thought I'd share. Anyway, let's get into this video, shall we? Who do I think Charles is? I think Charles is Ezra. I know I mention Ezra a lot, but that is because there are so many clues that point to him in my mind, and I've just always been suspicious of Mr. Fitzgerald there. For me, it all really came together with the video. There were, and I think Oliver Goldstick, I think he's the one that mentioned it is in fact Allie and Jason in that video. So then that leaves the second little boy unaccounted for. And the little boys look so close in age. And I've mentioned that I did some detective work and figured out that Cece, Ren, and Ezra all match in age. As does Melissa, but I really don't see it being her, if it was the transgender thing. And I narrowed it down to Cece or Ezra. And now, after much thought and deliberation, I'm going to have to go with Ezra. It just makes so much sense to me. Plus, Marlene did say that we've seen Big A in the pilot and then again in 3-1. And Ezra was in both of those episodes. In fact, if you went back and watched any of the 5 episodes that she said to watch for a big reveal, he was in all 5. And I think he was like the only character beside the girls that was in all 5 episodes, I think. I'm not sure. You guys correct me on that if I'm wrong. But then Oliver Goldstick also mentioned that we need to be focusing on the relationship between Charles and the De Laurentiis family. He said, don't focus on the twins so much. Just focus on that there is a relationship there. Okay. So it got me thinking, well, what if Ezra, it said Charles De Laurentiis, and I'm not sure if this was confirmed by Marlene King, if Marlene did say Charles De Laurentiis or just Charles. So if you guys know that, please let me know, because that would really help with this theory. But I think he is in fact De Laurentiis. And before we get much further into this, I want to explain what I think about him being A. I know a lot of people are saying, oh, he was already revealed as A. They're just doing, you know, that wouldn't work, stuff like that. Was he ever revealed as A? Did it come out of Marlene's mouth? I don't remember that for 100% certain. I know they had the hashtag Ezra at the end of that episode with the A capitalized, but I don't know if she ever said Ezra is A. She did say Ezra, or they did say in the show Ezra was writing the novel, but they never said he was A. He was never accused of being, like, never admitted to being A, like every other character that's A has ever done. So there is that. And who's to say? He could have been writing a book, but also the A at the same time. Anyway, I think Ezra is a relation of the De Laurentiis family. And if she did in fact say Charles De Laurentiis, it got me thinking, why is the last name De Laurentiis there? I don't think it's a twin of Jason because they don't look anything alike. But if Charles is a De Laurentiis, bear with me here, people, how would he get that last name? Through his dad, right? So I think that Ezra is Marion Cavanaugh and Kenneth De Laurentiis' son. And I think that's how he got the last name De Laurentiis. I've been really thinking about it, and I think that Marion and Jessica could very well be the twin sisters that they were referring to. And Marion, as we know, had serious mental issues, so maybe she tricked Kenneth into sleeping with her, or, you know, and that produced Ezra. Or it doesn't have to necessarily be Kenneth's son. It could just be Marion's son. And Marion had Ezra, and maybe she had Bethany, and then she had Toby. So I think that Marion is the mom, and I'm kind of shaky on if Kenneth is the dad, but I think it's a highly likely possibility at this point. And if he is Bethany's older brother, it would explain why Mrs. D wanted Bethany to call her Aunt Jessie that day. Marion could have given Ezra up because she thought she couldn't handle being a mom, or if we're looking at the video, Bethany would have already been born. And maybe Ezra did something to Bethany that made Marion think it was a danger. Maybe Marion just wanted to cut that part of her life out, or she only thought she could handle one child and they gave him up for whatever reason. They just gave him up. So let's see where I am. And I think that Marion kept, if it was Kenneth's son, kept that secret from Mrs. De Laurentiis. Mrs. De Laurentiis cheated on her husband with Peter Hastings, so why couldn't her husband cheat right back with Marion Cavanaugh? Who knows? Rosewood is a messed up place, right? Am I right? Thumbs up if I'm right. Let's see. Oh, this is what I was saying about I don't think it's the twin. Why would no one in Rosewood remember Jason having a twin? Like, why would none of the parents remember this? You know, it's highly likely that at least one person would figure things out. So why not, you know, put the pieces together? And I really don't think it's Jason's twin. And I said, for whatever reason, Ezra might not have known he was adopted, or he might have. It can go either way. But he's seeking answers about his actual biological family, and he begins to do research for his book. We know he started a book about his family. And he discovers that all paths about his family lead him to this little Pennsylvania town known as Rosewood. Rather than choosing to go to a prestigious college, you know, or an Ivy League school, like his family clearly had the money for, the Fitzgeralds were very wealthy, he chose to go to Hollis. Does anybody else, I kind of think Hollis, like, isn't Hollis a community college? Why would he go there? Oh, that's right, because Hollis is super close to Rosewood. And if he's in Hollis going to school and getting his education, which he would more than likely want to do and actively pursue on his own because he seems like a very intellectual person, then it would benefit him to be closer so he could continue doing research in his spare time. He's coming closer and closer to discovering the truth about his family, but the final piece of this puzzle is eluding him. And he can't figure out who his family is, like who they are in this town. One night, everything changes. At a bar near Hollis, he meets a young girl named Allison De Laurentiis. And he is very intrigued by her, almost to the point of obsession. Actually, we could say to the point of obsession, because a clue to this could be in the Lady Gaga song that was playing when they met, which was Paparazzi. And I just find the lyrics and so weird to go with this meeting, but it's, you know, I'm your biggest fan, I'll follow you until you love me. Kind of like stalker obsessed like. If we know anything about the show, they love to put meaning behind lyrics to their songs. You know, we look at Fresh Pair of Eyes, we look at Unwritten, which was the most recent one in the Welcome to the Dollhouse finale. And especially with Ezra and Arya scenes, there are a lot of meanings behind lyrics that we can pull out. So I just found this very notable. Okay. He decided then and there to drop the book he was working on about his family to instead go with a book about Allie, because as we know, he was kind of in a rut about writing about his family. And this is where he made the life-changing discovery that he was a De Laurentiis. I don't know how he stumbled upon it, but he did stumble upon a little piece to the puzzle that made everything click together, and he figured out that he was Marion Kavanaugh and Kenneth De Laurentiis' son, or just Marion Kavanaugh's. Let me know if you think Kenneth is the dad down below. Anyway, Ezra needed more info. He hired Cece Drake, as we all know, because he was paying her to give him information about Allie for his book. But he also wanted to infiltrate Radley and discover what happened to his mom. We know that Cece was there, and I'm assuming she was there before Bethany died. So she might have been there around the time Marion was there as well. But we know for 100% that she was there visiting Mona because she wanted to mentor her. And I don't think that might be true, actually, because I think both Cece and Mona are on Ezra's payroll. And I think both of them know who Charles is. On the night that Allie disappeared, Ezra's sister, Bethany Young, broke out of Radley, and Mrs. D called either Peter Hastings or talked to her husband about this, and one of them hit Allie in the head with the field hockey stick. So if it was, I think the strongest contender for me right now that hit Allie that night would be Peter Hastings, because he was so sketchy about the hockey stick back in season one, I think is when he burned it, maybe the beginning of season two. But because they were former lovers, Mrs. D confided in Peter. She finally figured out what was going on. She said, she thought Bethany was a threat to her family, because I firmly believe that she knows what happened to Marion. That's why she was on the board. That's why Bethany wrote all the mean things in her sketchbook about her. And that's why she was trying to buy Bethany off, because Bethany knows that Jessica had a part to play in Marion's death, if not being the one that pushed her, then knowing who did it and covering that up. So she confided to Mr. Hastings about what was going on. And he, she said, hey, be on the lookout for this. It's going to happen. And I think that he mistakenly hit Allie thinking it was Bethany. Could he have also hit Bethany, though? That is a very strong possibility. Maybe he hit Bethany earlier on, and then he saw who he thought was Bethany outside the De Laurentiis home, and he was like, oh, I didn't get the job done. Or maybe he hit Allie and then found Bethany. I don't know. I think it was Bethany, then Allie, if he was the same person. Because we know Melissa buried Bethany, but we don't know who hit her. And everybody says Allie was hit by a rock. We don't know that, because Allie was turned around. You know what I mean? Does that make sense? And then I think who Jessica was talking to on the phone when she's like, I can't protect you anymore. It was Mr. Hastings, because she was afraid that since her daughter was actually alive, she would remember something, and they couldn't let this cover up go on any longer. Okay. A distraught Ezra, who has just lost this girl that he is obsessing about, who turns out to be his half-sister, which, interjection here, guys. Everybody's saying Incensed, a theme, is gross. It's disgusting. They would be so disappointed if PLL went that way, and it can't possibly be true. Go back to A is for Answers and watch the frickin' Allie-Ezra scene in the car. Allie makes it a point to say, Ezra, we never did anything. If they kissed, okay, I think Melissa and Jason might have kissed, but that was before they knew their relation. And I think if Ezra and Allie kissed, it was before Ezra figured it out, because I don't think Allie figured it out first. I don't think she knows, actually, still. But it was before they figured out the relation. They never actually had sex, so it's not incest, guys. Okay. So he's just lost the girl he's been obsessing about and potentially his sister in one night. And he thinks that maybe one of the girls had something to do with Allie's death. So he needs to formulate a plot for revenge. Enter Mona, his little puppet. There are so many clues to me that Mona knows who Charles is and that Mona has been working with Uber A from the beginning. And I will get to them in the end of this video. But he found the perfect student in Mona because she hated Allie so much. And he was like, all right, here's this game I want to show you. And this is what you're going to do for me. And I'll provide you the funds to do it, kind of thing. Makes sense? I think it does. I think Ezra paid Mona to be his minion and kind of sat back in the shadows because, as we know, there are supposedly only two things that Mona did not do. One of them, obviously, Emily's massage. The other, I think, was killing Ian. And I think Ezra killed Ian because Ian had those videos and could bring everybody in Rosewood down. So, including Ezra, even though he was a newbie. Okay. When Mona went to Radley, Ezra either thought she would find out the truth about his family, which nobody knows, and he was kind of scared of that fact, or that she was too unstable to continue. So he decided, I'm going to send Cece in, get some information, and then we're going to steal the game back. Desperate to be accepted, Mona plays her final trump card, which is the fact that Allie is alive and she helped her escape that night. And at one point, Ezra would have been over the moon happy about it. But after finding out that they are half siblings and her family's involvement in Marion and potentially Bethany's deaths, he wants Allie to suffer. Okay. Now, after he figured out Allie is alive, my major thing that was not fitting with this puzzle was why continue to torture the girls? Because you know Allie's alive now. What if it has something to do with Marion? Because Marlene said that Marion has a bigger role to play in the solution. So what if he's mad at the parents of Rosewood? Because we know A likes to target parents, okay? And I was sitting there thinking about it today, and I thought, this is ridiculous to, okay, I'm gonna pick on these girls and then I'm gonna involve their parents. It would be the other way around, logically. You know, you're targeting the parents, and what better way to get to what parent than go after their child? That's any parent, you know? Even though Mrs. De Laurentiis is a crazy, crazy fool, I mean, I think she would do anything for her kids. Or she would have before Ezra, or maybe even, no, Ezra killed her. So, what do you guys think? Do you think Ezra could be A? I need more convincing? All right, let's get into some clues. Clues that Ezra is A. Like I mentioned before, he is in both season, both in the pilot episode and in season 3, episode 1. He was absent in season 3, episode 4 when A went to Montecito and got Caleb's mother in that car crash, which was very suspicious to me. And then there are all the Mona connections. There's Mona at Radley with the Queen of Hearts card, which I've talked about before, referencing, in my opinion, Alice in Wonderland, and who is the author of Alice in Wonderland, but Lewis Carroll, who is also, whose real name was Charles, and I think that signifies that Mona knew. There are the secret meetings in Shadow Play, when Mona is going to Ezra's apartment, and that could signify that they're working together. Then there's that meeting with Mona at the cafe, and he's kind of like threatening her without overly doing so. I don't remember which episode that is in, but I'm pretty sure you guys could find it when he's like, you know, she first comes back and he's like, I don't even remember, but he was kind of like making it a point to say, Mona, back off. And then we see Mona's room, which is all decked out in French things. And this is what really got me going on the fact that Mona and Cece could be on Ezra's payroll. Because at first I said, okay, who else has a French kind of thing going with them? And the only person I could think of was Cece because she went to France. But then I was watching an episode and I noticed something in Ezra's apartment. He has 3 or 4 French posters in his apartment. Call me crazy. I know. The money could have been, this is after the Mona connections. This is the next little thing. The $50,000 that he got could have been a loan because we saw A at the bank getting exactly $50,000 at the end of that episode, which is the amount he had. It also could have been an advance for his book, or maybe it was actually Jason's money, but I think more than likely it was a loan because he cut his family off. He cut his mom off and said he did not want anything to do with her. His biological mother. I mean, his adopted mother. You guys know what I mean. And then we, both A and Ezra have storage units. Mona's things were in a storage unit called Z1. And could this allude to Ezra's college nickname, which was Z? A little far-reaching there. I'm sorry. Then we also have the fresh pair of eyes song back in season one, which I want to see. I want to be seen with a fresh pair of eyes, like a single white tree in a black hood of disguise, I think. I thought it could also refer to Arya, but what if it is actually Ezra? Both A and Ezra like whiskey. Then there is the same train from Ezra's apartment that he was playing with Malcolm with in the dollhouse. And maybe the reason for the mannequin portrait in Arya's room is because he thought she could discover the truth. Because he really, after a while, has developed feelings for Arya. I'm not sure if he's in love with her, but he has developed these things for Arya. Okay. This is the biggest one for me. Ezra's Ravenswood lair and A's new lair in season 4, episode 17, I believe, have the same things in them. Like there's Allie's diary, there's the same poster of Cape May. There's so much stuff in them. In 418, we see A breaking into Emily's GPS with the apple there on the table. And everybody said, oh, that could point to Ezra. But I looked beyond the apple. And if you're going back and watching the ending A scene, on the right-hand side of that apple is a huge cup full of pens. Why would anyone need this many pens unless A, their teacher, which, yeah, but they weren't red, they were black, or B, they're a writer. I like to write and I have a computer, but there are certain times that I just need to jot things down and I always need pens. I have like 50,000 pens floating everywhere. Shut up, damn bird clock. Thank you. Okay, then we also get to the season 2 finale, which we were teased that A would be unmasked. Well, Ezra was unmasked. We found out in the Christmas episode that he has good taste in clothing, according to Holbrook. And then in 525, Arya is looking at the dress and she says, wow, A thought of everything. So again, good taste. And one of the very last things is the welcome messages when the girls are in the dollhouse. They are English, Spanish, and Icelandic. Which Ezra was in Iceland, so was Arya, you could argue, but I think it points to Ezra because if you look at some of the A actions, these things can only be done by an adult or an adult working with the A team, such as buying liquor, which maybe places wouldn't be so crazy with that. But you cannot lease an apartment if you are under a certain age. I'm sorry, that does not work for me. The very, very, very last thing for Ezra is that I think he is pretty eyes. Remember the diner, which I'm assuming is Jonah's, and we all know the waitress referred to Toby as pretty eyes, but she also referred to Black Hoodie as pretty eyes when he was in there with Dr. Sullivan, I believe, and I think it was Ezra because there are so many pies. Jonas is known for their pies, and pies are a common theme around Ezra. So that is it for this Ezra is A/Charles video. Let me know what you guys think down below. Feel free to poke holes or, you know, say why you think Ezra is A. I would love to hear them. Or who do you think is A? Let me know your thoughts down below. I'm thinking about doing a hangout sometime, like a Google Hangout between like the next 2 weeks or so. So let me know what you guys would think of that. And if you have any other suspects you would like to see, don't forget to let me know and I will work on theories for them that will be as detailed as this one was. Thank you guys so much for watching. If you haven't already, please hit that subscribe button. Give me a thumbs up if you like this video. And most importantly, leave your comments. You know what I'm going to say because I love talking about PLL with you guys. So thanks for watching. Bye.